Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. And in this video, I'm going to talk about populations and samples. So we'll start with the term population. So what does the population refer to? The population is everyone that we want to know about. So it's the group of people that we want to learn about, the group that we want to study. So if I want to know about college students, then anyone who's a college student would be part of that population. Of course, that's a very big population. There's a lot of college students. So I'm not going to be able to study all of them. And usually the populations we want to study are quite large. We want to know about all college students. We want to know about all people in general. And we can't study everyone. So we can't study the population. Instead, we have to choose some people from that population that we actually study. And those people are called the sample. So the sample are the people that we actually study. So if I want to know about college students, any college student is part of the population, but the college students that I actually bring into the lab and study would be my sample. So how do we go about choosing the sample from the population? Well, in ideal situations, we don't really choose, we make it random. We select a random sample. And this would mean that anyone from the population has equal chance of being in this study. The odds are the same for all members of the population, and we randomly choose a sample. This is ideal. But you can already sort of guess that this is going to be very hard to do. If I want to know about all college students, how am I going to randomly select from all college students all over the world and then fly them to my lab for this study? That's going to be impossible. I'm not going to be able to do that. So we almost never have random samples. The only time you can really have a random sample is if you have a very small population that you want to know about. Then you might be able to randomly select. But most of the time, we want to know about big populations. We want to know about all college students or all people in general. So we can't randomly select and have those be our participants. So what do we do instead? Instead, we have what's called an opportunity sample. Or you may also see it called a convenience sample. And this is just saying that we studied the people we had the opportunity to study, or it was convenient for us to study. So if I want to know about college students, that's my population, I might choose a sample that comes from a local college. Now, that's not random, but it's the people who were available to me. I had access to these college students, and I wanted to know about college students, so that's how they ended up being in my study. I might also choose to have a stratified sample. And what a stratified sample refers to is that I think there's certain features of the population that are important, certain demographics, and I want to make sure that my sample has those same demographics. So I might say, okay, I think maybe gender is important for the thing I'm studying. It might be relevant. So if in the population there's about, you know, half females and half males, then I want to make sure my sample also has that. Now, that's not random. That wouldn't be guaranteed to happen by random chance. But I might think it's important, and so I choose to stratify my sample that way. Similarly, I might say, okay, I want to know about U.S. citizens, and I see certain ethnic groups. Maybe I think it's relevant for my study, so I might choose to say, okay, I want, you know, this percentage of this ethnic group in my study, and I want this percentage of some other ethnic group. And so I can sort of go through and stratify my sample to ensure that the sample kind of looks like the population. And the reason for doing this is that we want to have representativeness. And all this term refers to is the idea that the sample represents the population. So representativeness is the idea that the group of people that I'm studying are able to stand in for or represent the entire group that I want to know about. Now, this is a very common criticism in psychology. It's often the case that we have a sample that's said to be non-representative. It doesn't really represent the population. Why is this such a common criticism? Well, the reason is fairly simple. Most research happens at universities, and who are the people that they're able to study in these, you know, universities? Mostly it's going to be undergraduates. It's going to be freshmen and sophomores, often psychology majors, who are able to get to come to the psych lab and do some experiments. And those people probably don't represent all people. College students are different from the rest of the population in certain ways, and that might matter. So they tend to be younger than average, they tend to be better educated than average, they tend to be wealthier than average, and these traits might be influencing the results that we're getting. So often we have non-representative samples. But this is not the end of the world. We don't give up. We don't say, okay, I can't get a representative sample for all people, therefore, what's the point? So there's three reasons why this is okay. And the first reason is fairly simple. We say that, okay, you've got limited data if you have a non-representative sample. But limited data is better than no data. We'd rather have some information about a non-representative sample. We might find an interesting effect here. That's better than not having any information at all. Now, we have to be careful because when we have limited data, we have to remember our conclusions must also be limited. So if I only study people from this particular sample, then I need to make conclusions only about this particular sample. I can't necessarily make conclusions about the whole population. The second reason why non-representative samples can be okay is that we can compare them. Okay, if researchers share their information with one another, then we can say, all right, I did my study with a non-representative sample, and you did your study with a different non-representative sample, and somebody else studied the same thing with another non-representative sample. Well, we can sit down and look at these three sets of data and see how they compare to one another. And if we find a similar effect amongst all three, that would imply that maybe this effect is general. Maybe this does apply to the whole population. So by comparing studies, groups of non-representative samples, we're able to get a better picture, and maybe we can make some general conclusions. And the third reason why non-representativeness is not the end of the world is that sometimes we assume generality. Sometimes we look at the results from a non-representative sample and we simply assume that they apply to everyone else. Now, you might say, Mike, that sounds like terrible science. That you're not supposed to do that. You shouldn't be looking at a non-representative sample and drawing large conclusions. And that's true, but sometimes it's okay. So when is it okay? Well, let's say that I have a new drug treatment and I give it to a bunch of people and they all get worse. They all have side effects and their symptoms worsen. I don't need to then say, well, this was a non-representative sample. I'd better give this drug to a lot more people. That is probably not a good idea, because in this case, we're going to assume generality. We're going to say, okay, even though these people were a different ethnic group, or even though they had a different educational background, or even they were a different gender than you, we're going to assume that these bad effects are going to happen to you too. We don't really know, but we're going to assume it to be on the safe side. And we actually do this in the extreme in some cases. So if I give a bunch of rats a drug and they all die, you probably don't want to try this drug. Now, you would certainly be correct in saying, well, rats are not a representative sample for the population of humans, but I'm willing to assume generality in this case. Okay, so that's populations and samples. I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.